I'm Tom Morello, host of Maximum Firepower, a weekly podcast focusing on the music, the moments, and the movements that have shaped my worldview and left an indelible mark on me as an artist and activist.
Come correct with Maximum Firepower.
Redwood Forest, Gulf Stream waters.
This land was made for you and me.
This is Tom Morello's Maximum Firepower. I'm Tom Morello. My guest today is Serj Tankian, longtime comrade in arms and singer of System of a Down. The people who have changed the world in progressive, radical, or even revolutionary ways did not have any more money, power, courage, intelligence, or creativity than anyone listening right now. The world is changed by average, everyday, ordinary people who have had enough, are willing to stand up for a country and a planet that is more humane, just, and decent. What can you do? Dream big and don't settle. For me, on the best of days, all I really do is play some cool guitar and amplify the voices of grassroots, rank-and-file fighters for social justice who work and toil and sacrifice with no hope of one day having a podcast on SiriusXM. It is their courage, and perhaps yours, that will help forge a more humane, just, and peaceful planet. The responsibility we have as artists is to tell the truth as we see it. If you do have a point of view and censor yourself, whatever your vocation, out of fear or passivity, you've done yourself and your times a grave disservice. At this historical juncture, it's all hands on deck. It's time to change the world, or at a bare minimum, to stir up a shitload of trouble. My guest today is Serj Tankian, known for changing the world, rocking out, and stirring up a shitload of trouble. Serj, how are you today?
Good, brother. How are you?
I'm all right. Thanks very much for being on the show here. Serj and I have been acquainted for quite some time. And I don't know that I've ever shared this story with you, but the first time that I ever heard of System of a Down was Rick Rubin, who had spent, you know, some time with the band, asked me to come see you guys play at the Viper Room, a club in Hollywood that holds about 60 people max. And you roared the place to the ground. And it reminded me in some ways of like the first time I heard Metallica. My ears were not ready to understand what was happening. You know, it was a combination of brilliant new vectors making a new kind of rock and roll that I didn't have sort of a grid to even hang it on. And Rick was like, so what do you think about those guys? And would you think of like producing them? I'm like, I don't think I could make that better. It's so feral and so what it is on its own. Like, I'm quite positive I could make it worse, but I don't, by moving some of those edges. But anyway, so it's been a real pleasure making.
I did not know that story. You've never told me that all these years. No kidding.
Yeah, Rick and I were on the phone, and he was just looking for somebody to produce the record cheaply.
Was that the first time Rick had seen us, or he had seen us?
I believe that was the first time Rick saw you, was at that Viper.
So you came with him that first time to the Viper? That's amazing. So we talk about this, because obviously Rick and yourself are in the documentary Truth to Power that we just put out. And, you know, he talks about the first time that he saw us at the Viper Room show and how, more than anything, he was just laughing because he was so over the top that he just couldn't believe it. Wow, you were there, dude.
I was absolutely there. And it did, you know, looking back both on that show and now that the world's ear has attuned to that unique combination of metal and the way that you and your band have sort of synthesized elements of your heritage into the genre of hard rock music. You know, there's no one else in that lane. You know what I'm saying? Like it's by being absolutely true to yourselves of who you are, both as people who like metal music and who heard Armenian folk songs as children, I'm guessing, by synthesizing those, you made a kind of music that no one else could have possibly made. So let me ask this. So you have a movie out called Truth to Power. First of all, tell us what the movie is.
The movie is basically an activist journey. You know, in 2011, I had gone out and strapped a camera to my head, spy glasses, and shot everything that I did professionally because it was going to be a very interesting, diverse professional year, playing with orchestras, coming back and playing with System of a Down for the first time since our hiatus, my backup band, the FCC, like just a plethora of creative, musical, and political events all throughout the year. So I thought I'd tape it all. I just didn't know how to process it. In other words, it was a very point of POV kind of movie. It was just a lot of amazing footage, but without a proper storyline going through it. And then I met a good friend of mine, a director, Garin Hovhannisyan, we were talking about this, and he's like, what's the real story you want to tell? And I'm like, I'm not really interested in a biography. I'm not interested in the as much the musical rock star aspect. I'm interested in the activist in this whole story. And so we presented the musical thing, the launch of it, but really, it's really seeing this activist who had a small voice because it wasn't projected through a huge band. It was just an activist. And then slowly through the success of the band, that voice becomes huge in terms of its reach. And you see the repercussions of that as well that you and I have both dealt with for many years, as well as some of the success stories that you see from it.
So how we first became acquainted as friends, were now you've told me that you were at some crazy party at my house on a New Year's Eve, and that's when we first actually met. Now, neither myself nor my attorneys can confirm or deny that. But anyway, so Axis of Justice was an organization that you and I formed, and the genesis of the idea for it was an Ozfest show. Audio Slave and System of a Down, I believe, are going to share a stage at some Ozfest. But anyway, I went to go see Ozfest at San Bernardino, and I was walking through the audience. I was appalled by the number of like white power tattoos I saw on fans. You know, and metal had changed by this point. I think it was probably 2000, 2001, where every band on the main stage had at least one non-white member. And yet there was this kind of acceptance in the audience of the racist points of view. I thought there needs to be a voice that is an anti-racist voice, that is a social justice voice, a voice letting fans of music, hard rock and metal music, know that we're here too. You know, and so that was, I called up Serj and we started talking about forming an organization called Axis of Justice. And the first act that we took as an organization was there was this draconian measure where the city of Santa Monica had disallowed individuals or businesses from feeding homeless people as a way to sort of like drive them out. And so anyway, so the first thing that Axis of Justice did, and the first time that Serj and I really spent some time together, was we went on the radio. We said we'd like our fans to come down, bring all the food you can carry, and we're going to give food to every homeless person in Santa Monica, you know, on a Saturday afternoon. And so what are your memories of that first day of sticking
it was great. The there was press there, and we really, I think, made an impact, and people, you know, started kind of paying attention to that particular cause, you know, and it was ridiculous, you know, and so we stood up against it. And that was the first time you and I definitely physically converged and actually had conversations about it. The time I remember that you called me about the idea of Axis of Justice, I remember it vividly because you guys were going to play Ozfest as Citizen Kane before you even had Audio Slave as a name.
It was just called Civilian. Yes, Civilian.
Oh, Civilian. Oh, okay. Civilian. I thought it was Citizen Kane or something. But yeah, you said, look, we were going to do Ozfest. I don't think we're going to be able to do it, but I had this idea of having this organization so that kids not only have merch booths to go to, but there's somewhere where they can go get information about justice, different causes, different organizations that might be beneficial, etc. And I'm like, that's fantastic, let's talk to Sharon. And you know, and we did, and we started Axis of Justice and all these incredible concerts, these huge festivals. We had our booths there and invited different organizations, Amnesty International, Greenpeace, like so many different organizations that we work with.
Yeah, and the idea was to basically answer the question that our fans had, I mean, people have been asking me since, you know, the first Rage Against the Machine show, and perhaps you as well, is how do I get involved? And I was like, I grew up in a town where there was no access to changing the world. You know, now with the internet, it's different, but Axis of Justice was like a watering hole. And we had a website and we had a radio show on KPFK for years. Whereas if you were a fan and you were interested in a particular issue, it might be environmental justice, you were two clicks away from finding the organization in your area that was fighting for that cause and really like sort of plugging individual people in to larger grassroots movements to try to like move the meter. And I was very proud of the work that we did together and a lot of great music along the way. I mean, the whole idea was the synergy between, it wasn't a bunch of like dry college lectures, it was some great rock and roll shows, including the Justice Tour shows and the shows at the Hotel Cafe, which kind of were legendary. What are your memories of that event?
I remember one of the first Justice shows that we had, Axis of Justice show, it was at the one that we released as a CD DVD. You remember?
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. I know what you're talking about. Yeah, yeah, yeah. The Palace. It used to be called
The Palace. That's right. They're right across Capitol Records. That was an incredible show.
Yeah.
And so many amazing artists. Chris Cornell and Maynard was there. And like just
Flea was there.
Flea was always there, bro. Yeah. I remember we did one of our shows at the Troubadour and someone was supposed to play bass on stage and we're all downstairs literally with our instruments and the bass player either didn't show up or something happened. I ran up the stairs, that little room in the, you know, upstairs at the Troubadour, and I'm like, Flea, We need you. He was literally, he had spaghetti in his mouth coming out of his mouth. He was eating. Poor guy was eating. He literally just goes, and grabbed his bass and ran down. Yeah. I'll never forget that.
And nailed it. I totally remember that. I think, I'm not sure what it was, but I remember at least one of the songs we played that night was Get Up, Stand Up by Bob Marley. And I just said, it's Get Up, Stand Up. We're not playing the intro. And he's like, why are we not playing the intro? It's like, because you're the only one that knows it, all right? You just joined the band, and you know, we don't know it. We're just trying to get by here, man. So the idea for these Axis of Justice shows, and then what sort of morphed into the Justice Tour, which traveled across the country, was it was always $10 at the door, the people's price to get in. We gave away 100% of the proceeds to local charity or activist organizations in whatever city it was. And it was really an idea to get sort of back to, like, remember why you started, like, as a musician and as an activist. Remember why you started. And it's just for the joy of the playing music, connecting with other musicians, connecting with an audience. At the end of the day, like, those are some of my most I remember the Hotel Cafe, which holds about 150 people. And, you know, sometimes there'd be a line of about 1,000 people outside wrapped around the corner with people, like, listening to the walls. Because, you know, one night it might be Cypress Hill. It might be some local homeless kid who I saw busking who I asked to play. It might be Motley Crue. You know, Perry Farrell was always there. And so what we would do is, in between the acts on stage, we'd ask the musicians to just go out into the alley and play for the people who were not going to get in. So there was like a second show kind of right outside the front door. And it really felt like the spirit of, you know, why we started doing it to begin with. So I have a question for you. So compare and contrast for me, because we both have been in bands and we both have vibrant musical, political activities outside of our bands as solo artists and as activists. For me, the way I've looked at it is like a band provides chemistry and it creates something that none of the individuals could alone, and that unique combination of 3, 4, 5, however many people, it's a fingerprint. It's a snowflake. There's nothing like it. There's nothing like that particular thing. And when it's great, it's because of that chemistry. With a solo artist, what you get is a purity of vision. You get something that is uncut by band meetings or differing opinions, and you get a very purity of vision. You know, we've had the good fortune to sort of be on both sides of that line. I'd like to get your thoughts about, you know, sort of the strengths and weaknesses, pros and cons of being a solo artist versus playing in a band setting.
Absolutely. I agree. I think being in a band like your band or my band, it's so unique. It's such, if any part of that formula changes, if any one person leaves, it'll never be the same again.
That's right.
And so the reason that there's been success is the potency of that combination. It's that push and pull, you know, it's not one thing. It's like that push and pull that creates this special magic, I think. And as a solo artist, look, yeah, you have a vision for a song. It's way easier to enact it if you have a full understanding and vision of the music that you want to finish.
Yeah.
But if you just have ideas and you need collaborators, then a band situation obviously is much more conducive to that. But yeah, you're right. It's like one is straight, true vision without any wranglings. The other is like this monster that could do anything, but has done incredible things and is irreplaceable in every way.
And the thing that, you know, throughout your career, I sort of saw myself as like being in one band for forever. And then when that was not the case, it opened up a lot of, like, I've made 20 albums now. You know, I've made four
Amazing,
Rage Against
bro.
The Machine albums, but I've made 20 albums now, you know, from Audioslave to Street Sweeper to Night Watchman to some Springsteen records and whatnot. And is it afforded this kind of, this unexpected and rich mosaic of experiences that I never would have had otherwise. You know, like, I've jammed with Wu-Tang Clan and I've jammed with Pete Seeger. You know what I mean? I've jammed with Slayer, you know, and I've jammed with The Prodigy. I'm Tom Morello, and this is Tom Morello's Maximum Firepower. We are hanging out with Serj Tankian here, talking about everything under the sun. Talking about everything under the sun. All right. So one of the things that we run into as musician activists is the old shut up and play guitar. Now, I know you get it, and I know I get it. Now, here's the one thing. That if you're Noam Chomsky delivering a college lecture, or if you're someone who, you know, like in my folk guise as the Night Watchman, if you're coming to a Night Watchman show, I'm going to sing some folk songs about topical issues and point fingers at people, so you know what you're getting into. But when you're in a rock and roll band that casts the nets a lot wider as far as the spectrum of fans who are drawn to it, shut up and play the guitar, or shut up and sing, shut up and entertain me, do your little dance, monkey, and stop talking about stuff that upsets me, is something that you'll often see in the comment section. Your thoughts on that?
Look, I get it all the time, and I get it from every side when someone disagrees with me. And to me, it's like it really makes me think, who are we? Like, are we defined by what we do? You know, if I was a roofer or, you know, if I had a political statement, would you just say, go do your fucking roofing and don't talk to me about politics? Like, that is so horrible, you know? Like, yeah. What does that have to do with, you know, we're beings that are diverse beings. We have interests. We have intellect. And so I find it, it's offensive, but I'm used to it at this point. So yeah. I don't really get offended. Yeah. I just, yeah, whatever, you know, kind of thing. But it is a go-to. It's a very, very common go-to.
I think it represents a cognitive dissonance in parts of the audience where, like, the people who are telling you and me to shut up and play guitar and shut up and sing don't mind a game show host as president. You know what I mean? Like, they don't mind at all because they may agree with that.
Or
you know, but it really speaks to the fact that there's this cognitive dissonance, and I love the music and I love the mosh pit, and I'm uncomfortable with the ideas that it contains. And so my thought was, like, if you're able to make music or any sort of art that everyone can agree upon and that everyone can hold hands and kumbaya how much they love it, you're probably making some pretty shitty art.
Definitely.
That's the way I look at it. I mean, I get
my favorite comments are when someone, you know, I mean, there's people that agree with you, there's people that disagree with you, but my favorite is when someone goes, you know, I really like your music and I really like your passion and I appreciate it, but I don't agree on these points. I'm like, I love this person.
Because they're actually thinking and they're actually engaged.
Yeah. Like, this is awesome. Yeah, don't agree with me. It's okay.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, but just to go, fuck you, go play your music and don't say anything else. Yeah. That's like, you know.
I think it's perfectly okay and preferable to make an audience choose sides. I mean, that's what I think effective art does. You know, it's like your music can be so compelling that it draws people of various backgrounds and various ideas because they love the aggression, because they love whatever, Ellen, the guitar solos or the timbre of your voice. They're drawn to it and want to get down with it. And yet they're confronted with ideas that are uncomfortable. And I think that's fine. That's what art's supposed to do.
Exactly.
All right. So one of the things that is very impressive to me about your work is, like, one foot of both System of a Down and your own work is firmly planted in your Armenian heritage. The connection that your band has with the global Armenian community. But there was a show that you played, I believe it was on the 100th anniversary of the Armenian genocide in Armenia. Tell me a little bit about the feeling, because I saw the video of that, and it really transcended the idea of a rock and roll show. And it was something that was deeply, like, sort of spiritual. And it was like, it was a band that has had a lot of successes and this and another, but it felt like it was a band that was built for that particular day.
Armenians are a small nation. We're the full population of Armenians around the world, mostly in the diaspora due to the genocide, are probably 8-9 million, you know, all in. So when we have something to be proud of, we're very proud of it, you know, and we're thankful that our people are proud of our band because we're all of Armenian heritage. When it came to that show, I remember, it was the first time that System of a Down played in Armenia in 2015 for the 100th anniversary commemoration of the genocide. It felt like the band was created to play that show. Like, everything we had done was precursor to that show. It felt like the apex of our existence. It felt that's, you know, climax of our, you know, musician, everything. And on stage, it felt like we were rocking, so we were entertaining, obviously. We were speaking truth to power against the corrupt Armenian government at the time and saying specific things. At the same time, we were speaking to the world regarding genocide recognition, because the show was also live streamed by RollingStone.com around the world. So there was, like, these incredible activist music. And at the same time, I'm looking at these young people in front of me and I see the future of that nation in their eyes, not knowing that 3 years from then, there's going to be this incredible, peaceful velvet revolution that occurred in 2018. So that moment was just like the collision of all these incredible worlds that you and I live on a daily basis, culminated and climaxed into this incredible moment. It was just amazing.
Yeah, I mean, it really speaks to the potential of rock and roll. I mean, people ask, you know, can rock and roll change the world? I mean, obviously, you know, it's changed our lives personally, but on a night like that, you see, like, the tangibility of that kind of connection that is much more than, you know, there's a mosh pit in people's minds as well as in, you know, in front of the stage. So talk to me for a second. Like it's important to acknowledge that there can be a radical component to music irrespective of lyrics. You know what I mean? Like Hendrix's version of the Star Spangled Banner, where he channels the uncertainty and the cacophony and the napalm of the Vietnam War era and the cultural revolution that was happening through his guitar playing a 3.5-minute song. John Coltrane upending the world's ears by how an instrument could be played and the choices of notes And, you know, I've attempted in my own work to outflank the traditional three chords and the truth or Van Halen soloing, to look at the instrument in a way as, you know, one that's fun to do, and two, it's a statement. Your singing, I would say, is an example of that. Regardless of the words, which are often potent politically and whatnot, but you're tapping into the melodic history of Armenia and then bringing that, like transfiguring that into a rock and roll band. That in and of itself is a political act, I think.
So it's funny you say that, because I always give Rage Against the Machine as an example of intuitive kind of response to music. So when I first heard Rage, when I first heard your band, I loved it not because I understood the lyrics, because the first thing I got was this guttural physical reaction to the music and Zach singing, which was part of the music. I wasn't understanding the words. I processed the words later, which gave it even more strength and logical kind of resonance. But the first thing I felt was this strong feeling of like your body's moving and you're angry and you're like, what the fuck is this, right? Like, it's just the music itself, you know?
Yeah,
music can do that. And I always say that that's how we co-inspire. We're inspired as artists. We present this inspiration to others. We inspire them intuitively at first, and then they can process the logical side of that. And once their left brain is involved, then they can actually act. And that action itself can change the world, because it changes their reality.
Absolutely. All right, a couple more things to talk about. You and I have a long history of collaborating on stage and in the studio. Remember the first time we collaborated, we were over at Rick Rubin's house, and I said, hey, I make acoustic albums, and I would love to, you know, to sing a song. I played you some stuff, and I wrongly assumed that you might gravitate towards sort of the more rocky numbers and more kind of aggressive numbers, and you chose a song called Lazarus on Down, which was this kind of dark New Testament rumination. And I just thought that was really, it helped me to understand you better as an artist. And then later I played on your record. What was the first jam that we did on something 21?
Gate 21.
Yeah, Gate 21.
Yeah,
we played
Gate 21. Gate, you rocked it.
Anyway, just my experience with you in the studio has been much like on stage in our friendship. Like, sometimes people come up to me like, you know, they think that I'm, because of the riffs and whatnot on the records, that I'm going to be like a very aggressive dude or whatever. And, you know, you listen to System of a Down records, and Serj is like the gentlest, most lovely. I mean, you don't want to get on his wrong side. Don't get me wrong. But, you know, just like listening to you sing on Lazarus on Down, and, you know, just a real pleasure to, you know, to rock that jam.
I love singing that with you. I love it.
Well, more recently, we've, you know, on tour when we've crossed paths, you've sung the Audioslave song Like a Stone, either with me at my solo shows or with Prophets of Rage. And just sort of tell me what that experience was like, because I know that you knew Chris well.
I had seen Chris a couple of months before he passed, and, you know, we were sitting next to each other at Elton John's birthday, actually, was the last time I saw him. And we were talking about the future, and, you know, he was excited about the different tours, about the different projects he was going to do. I was telling him, dude, you got to do an orchestral tour, like a live orchestral show. I'll help you any which way I can. I'll arrange for you. You know, I mean, your voice is going to be incredible with an orchestra, and I'm a huge fan of his music, Soundgarden, growing up. And that was the last I saw him. And so when you guys were doing the tour, and when you asked me, will you do this song, I was like, it was tough not to come to tears every night performing that song. And so, but I'm glad we were able to pay respects, our musical respects to him.
Yeah.
So yeah, that was amazing. Just very moving every night. He is sorely missed.
In wrapping up, so tell me about the film and its intent.
Yeah, so Truth to Power, you can watch it at truthtopowerfilm.com. There's like all these virtual theatrical websites that you can get a ticket and watch it just like as you're in a movie theater from your home. The film is basically highlighting the activist journey through music. Plenty of amazing System of a Down and solo musical footage and fun times and also some controversies and all of that stuff. I think the director did a phenomenal job. I was so proud of him. And we did another film together called I Am Not Alone that's coming out this year, which is a documentary about the 2018 Velvet Revolution in Armenia. It is a powerful, award-winning film. And so I can't wait to show that to you as well. You haven't seen that one. It's one of those things where it really inspires you to make change.
All right, well, Serj, thank you very much. I hope when you know, we're able to see each other in person. Best to you and lots of love to the family. Serj is a living example of what I believe we have one responsibility as musicians, and that's just to tell the truth as we see it. Thanks very much for being on Maximum Firepower.
See Congratulations on the show. Much love to you, brother.
Let foes of justice tremble.
This has been Tom Morello's Maximum Firepower.
Hear this episode again
or listen to past shows right now
on the SiriusXM app.
Search Maximum Firepower.